All members, please come to the floor. All members of the Georgia House, please come to the floor. Well, good morning. The hour for convening having arrived. All members, please take their seats. Mr. Clerk, will you please ring the bell? All members, please take your seats. If I didn't know better, I think y'all thought this was day 35 and the session was almost over. It could be. If it wasn't for that one thing that Chairman Hatch has been working on. If we had that done, Chairman Hatch, we'd go home this afternoon. It'd suit me. We're going to have the morning roll call. All members present will please vote green to signify their presence in the chamber. And Mr. Clerk, will you unlock the machine? Have all members now voted their presence in the chamber? If all members have voted, Mr. Clerk, will you please lock the machines? Doorkeepers, will you please close the doors and keep them closed? Special day in the Georgia House. Many days are, but none more special than this one. But we'll get to that in a few minutes. As is our custom, we will begin our day with scripture reading and prayer by the chaplain, after which we will pledge allegiance to the flag of our country. I have the great honor of not introducing, but recognizing our chaplain of the day today, Chairman Mack Jackson. As many of us in this house had the distinction over the years to have a fine, fine man call us his friend. And on many occasions, I heard Speaker David Ralston call Mack Jackson his friend. And he also called Valerie Jackson his friend as well. Valerie, if you'll stand up, let us welcome you to the People's House. Mack Jackson's a man of God. Speaker Ralston was a man of God, and they recognized that trait in each other. Some of you probably heard this story, but I'll tell you again. Unless you're going to tell it, but I'm going to tell it. So a surprise, I'm not sure if Corporal Moody was with the speaker that day when they showed up down in Sandersville. What's that other large city in? Yeah, Tinnell. Those of you who've been down to Washington County, those Tinnells are really a really big city down there. But so when some cars showed up outside this little country church, St. James Christian Fellowship Church, it created quite a commotion. Fair to say, quite a commotion, and it also surprised the pastor, who was able to welcome his friend, his speaker, to a service in his church. This kind of guy, this kind of man, David Ralston was. So with that, I want to invite our colleague, Chairman Mack Jackson, to bring us a devotion for today. Mr. Chairman.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. It's an honor to be here today to help to celebrate this occasion for my friend, the late Speaker David Ralston. Greetings to my colleagues, our special guests, the Ralston family, and all that came with him. I see some of the staff from his old office sit here with us, and it just seems like old times today. But I don't have 5 minutes today, so I'll be very brief, so that we can get on with the other programs. But in old church, they always taught us when we get up to say, I give honor to God, who is the head of my life, and to his son, Jesus Christ. When we're here today for a special occasion, and I'm truly honored, Mr. Speaker, to be called upon to participate in this event. Speaker Ralston was my friend. And as I was considering what would be appropriate from the Word of God, from the Scriptures, to say about David Ralston, I thought about Esther 4 and 14, where Mordecai told Esther, and who knows whether thou art been called to the kingdom for such a time as this. But then I thought about Jeremiah 1 and 5, before I formed thee in the belly, I knew thee. And before thou came forth out of the womb, I sanctified thee, and I ordained thee a prophet unto the nations. I thought about 2 Timothy 1 and 9, who has saved us and called us with a holy calling, not according to our works, but according to his own purpose and grace, which was given us in Christ Jesus before the world began. You see, Speaker Ralston lived out his purpose every day. He was like someone who was in the right place at the right time to fulfill his destiny. And I remember a song that Charles Wesley wrote, a song that we used to sing too in the old church. And the song says, a charge to keep I have, a God to glorify, a never dying soul to save, and fitted for the sky. But this is what I like, and it epitomizes Speaker Ralston. To serve the present age, my calling to fulfill. Oh, may it all my powers engage to do my master's will. And I believe that he was a man of purpose. He was a man that saw a need for the state of Georgia. And Georgia's a better place because of David Ralston. He was a friend to the least. And Jesus told us the way to be successful in life is to serve. And Speaker Ralston had a heart of service. He saw a need and he served the least of them. The ones that couldn't give anything back, he served them with all his heart. But on November 16, 2022, I believe he heard these words that Paul said in 2 Timothy 4 and 6. For I'm now ready to be offered, and the time of my departure is at hand. I have fought a good fight. I have finished my course. I have kept the faith. Speaker Ralston finished his course. And now I believe he has a crown of righteousness because of what he did here in the General Assembly, in life, in Blue Ridge, and all over the state of Georgia. He was a man of destiny, and I believe he finished his course. You see, ladies and gentlemen, Speaker Ralston made this state a better place, and he finished his course. And may God continue to bless his family, and may God continue to bless the great state of Georgia, shall we pray. Guide me, O thy great Jehovah, pilgrim through this barren land. I am weak, but thou art mighty. Hold me with thy powerful hand. Bread of heaven, feed me till I want no more. Feed me till I want no more. Bless this family, Lord. Bless this General Assembly, Father. Bless the man, Lord, who has left behind footprints in the sands of time, Lord. And we ask for your wisdom and your guidance upon Speaker Burns and the rest of the General Assembly as we complete the great work that was started by our friend. Father, we thank you for this great occasion today, and may your hand be upon each one of us. In Jesus' name, amen. Would you join me in the Pledge of Allegiance?
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Speaker Ralston loved you, and you inspired him, as you do all of us. Thank you for those words of remembrance, and certainly those words that encourage us to continue the work of a great man. Thank you, Mack. Doorkeepers, you may unlock the doors. Members, you can go to the south anteroom if you'd like and greet the chaplain, or you can do what you do every day, is talk to him on the floor, but that's your choice. Members, I think y'all know the order of the day, well, the business where we will be about, and I will let you know that we have many guests on the floor, and they will be purposefully acknowledged shortly. One of my favorite things to do I can hit that almost as good as he could there, but not quite. Members, I want you to give the chairman your attention. Chair recognizes Chairman Tarvin, the Chair of the Committee on Information and Audits. Chairman Tarvin.
Mr. Speaker, your Committee on Information and Audits has read the journal from the previous legislative day and found it to be correct. And if you will indulge me, I usually try to make my statements every day gender neutral, but today on this special day, The monument of a great man is not of granite or marble or bronze. It consists of his goodness, his deeds, and his compassion. Happy birthday, Speaker David Ralston.
Well said, my friend. Well said. I can always count on you to be politically correct, I may say. Chairman Tarvin, the chair of the Committee on Information and Audits, reports that the journal of the previous legislative day has been read and found to be correct. Is there any objection to dispense with the reading of the journal? Chair hears none. The reading of the journal is dispensed with. Is there any objection to the confirmation of the journal? Chair hears none, and the journal is confirmed. Mr. Clerk, will you read the resolution establishing the order of business for the day?
Representative, Association of the 104th moves following me establishes the order of business for the first part of the period, unanimous consents, introduction of bills and resolutions, first reading and reference of House bills and resolutions, second reading of bills and resolutions, first reading and reference of Senate bills and resolutions, morning orders.
Is there any objection to the adoption of the resolution establishing the order of business for the day? Chair hears none, and the resolution is adopted. First reading of bills and resolutions, Mr. Clerk, will you read?
Chairman, it completes the reading of the reports of standing committees.
Thank you, Mr. Clerk. Members, if you will, please take your seats. We'll move on to morning orders, and as most of you have been informed, we will not have any morning orders from the members this morning, but we do have an invite resolution. Members, we have guests on the floor today. The House will come to order. Members, please take your seats. As Speaker Ralston reminded me from time to time, I'll remind y'all, take your conversations to the two ante rooms or cease them and take your seats. We have an invite resolution. It's very appropriate for this time of year. I hope all of you have your green on. Mr. Clerk, will you read the caption to a resolution, House Resolution 1224?
House Resolution 1224 by Representative Carson, the 46th, Bonner, the 73rd, Hatchett, the 155th, Stevens, the 164th, and Petrie, the 166th, a resolution recognizing and commending Minister Peter Burke.
Thank you, Mr. Clerk. We'll now recognize Chairman John Carson to speak to the resolution. Chairman Carson.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. Well, good morning, everybody. Today is March 14th. We have St. Patrick's Day coming up, just like the speaker said, and it's coming up fast, including this Sunday is the 200th anniversary of the Savannah St. Patrick's Day Parade. There's over 1 million Georgians that, like myself, have Irish ancestry. My own family immigrated from Newry, Ireland, right around 200 years ago. With that, I'd like to recognize a delegation from the Ireland Consulate here in Atlanta, Cuive Ní Chuir, Consul General. Did I do that right? Okay. Emir Nolan, Vice Consul. Connor Madden, Private Secretary, and Laura Mannion, Special Advisor. Will you welcome them to the House? In addition, we have they're all with the consulate staff here on Peachtree Road in Buckhead. But we also have with us today, straight from Dublin, Ireland, the Minister Peter Burke. Peter's constituency is from Langford, Westmeath. Did I say that correct? That's in sort of north central Ireland, west of Dublin. He is the Minister of State for European Affairs and Defense. Straight from Dublin, Ireland, Minister Peter Burke. Minister.
Good morning, everyone. Thank you, Speaker Burns. Really appreciate your time and being here, and also Governor Kemp. I really want to acknowledge and thank both of you for facilitating this, and Representative Carson, which we really appreciate. Could I firstly just pay my respects to former Speaker Ralston, who was a great friend of my country, and I've heard the great remarks that have been made here this morning in respect of him, so I really want to pass on my respects as the country he last visited, I understand, and had a very good and enjoyable experience there, and to your family as well, just to acknowledge that. We're really a special day for us, obviously, with St. Patrick's Day on Sunday, and we are very privileged to be here in the United States, a relationship which we value so much, very dear friends. We have now 9 missions in the United States. Our Consulate General here in Georgia opened in 2010, a country that here, 9.5% of its population claim Irish heritage, about 32 million people, and as your representative said, about 1 million here in Georgia. And the definition, I think, of a good bilateral relationship, dear friends, is that it works both ways. Here in Georgia, we have about 7,000 people employed by Irish companies, a sign of the FDI investment, companies like Curry and CRH on the ground here operating, employing people. I think that's a real evidence that the relationship is working well both ways. So I really want to thank everyone for that. We are investing heavily as an Irish government in the relationship because we value the friendship. We know how much the relationship means to us, and we always remember the great help we got during Northern Ireland to try and get the Assembly back up and running during the time of the Good Friday Agreement. It was a very special time in our history, and the friendship really paid dividends again for us at that particular time. We have 2 points to make in our mission this year, which is very important to us in Ireland. Firstly, our dear friends in Ukraine. We think it is very important that we stand very clearly with Ukraine. I know from being a member of the European Union, it is the first war on mainland Europe in a generation. And a country's territorial integrity, the international rules-based order, the right to self-determination is at stake. And if we in any way yield or lose a resolution towards Ukraine, the consequences will be stark, dear friends. We've agreed a 50 billion euro budget through the European Union to help them with their economy into the future. And it's so important we do stand firmly with them. The second very brief thing is I want to really acknowledge the US administration and the work they are doing trying to seek a ceasefire in the Middle East. We as a government have been very clear in our condemnation of Hamas and their act on October 7th. We are very crystal clear on our demand for all hostages to be released immediately. But we also see it is so important to protect vulnerable people. We need to get humanitarian corridors right into the heart of Gaza immediately, because we cannot have a collective punishment of very vulnerable people. And that is so important to us as an Irish country. We really need to see that. And I thank the US administration for working with interlocutors in the region to try and achieve that. So the last thing I want to say is that August 24th, Georgia Tech are going to win in Dublin. So go Yellow Jackets. Thank you.
Very good. Thank you.
Thank you, sir.
House will come to order. House will come to order. The House will come to order. We have a special day today. Members will please take your seats. Members will please take your seats. We will have the unveiling of the portrait of Speaker Ralston and his dedication today. We have a number of guests on the floor with us, and I know you will, without me asking, that you provide your undivided attention to this great day. I'm going to ask two gentlemen that were very close to Speaker Ralston to come over and do the honor of unveiling the portrait. His dear friend and former colleague, Chief of Staff, former Appropriations Chair Terry England, and his Chief of Staff, a man that he felt like was a son to him, Spiro Amburn. If you two gentlemen will come over and do the honor. You'll stand, members. Couple of tidbits. The University of North Georgia commissioned this painting, and it was done by Travis Massey from Gainesville. He did an excellent job. What a great likeness of a fine, fine gentleman. If you will, be seated. We'll have some comments. I'll keep mine brief, but I want to recognize a couple of folks that are here, and I'm going to ask you to stand and be recognized, and we'll start with three very, very important folks in Speaker Ralston's life, as we all were, I think is the case. But I want to recognize Matt Ralston, his son. Elizabeth was here earlier this morning, his daughter, and certainly his bride, Cherie. And so we appreciate you all being here. Thank you for being here. But if she's not online now, she'll see this soon. Speaker Ralston's mother, Miss Ernestine. Who don't love the mama? That's a good, but I tell you what, Speaker Ralston loved his mother and was always so proud to talk about it, and she stood with him. sitting with him day in and day out. And I think I thought about something else he was very proud of. A gentleman named Willard Ralston, who was clerk of court for many, many years up in Fannin County. You know, I think Speaker Ralston got his love of public service from a lot of people, but I know his dad's imprint for public service and how he cared about his fellow man and his mother's were always on his mind and on his heart. So we appreciate and remember his dad, as Speaker Ralston always did fondly. His brother, Dennis, if you'll stand. We appreciate you. You know, there's no stronger bond than between brothers and sisters. And I know that Speaker Ralston spoke often of his brothers, and he loved them dearly. I'm not going to be able to recognize everyone that was so important to Speaker Ralston, but I'm going to hit a couple, but we'll move on through this. As I just recognized, and Spiro Ambrin helped unveil the painting, Speaker Ralston's chief of staff, a gentleman that Speaker Ralston felt so strongly about, and I know that Spiro saw Speaker Ralston as a father figure. So, Spiro, we appreciate your service to Georgia, but especially your friendship and service and support for Speaker Ralston. Thank you for that. All of us know here in this place the work that we do could not be done alone. So I want to recognize three ladies that were especially helpful in directing Speaker Ralston. And I say that very strongly, directing Speaker Ralston. His executive assistants, Diane Harden, if you'll stand. Thank you, Diane. We appreciate you coming back. Speaker, you had a special place in Speaker Ralston's heart. Miss Lisa Johnson. Where's Lisa? Lisa, thank you. He loved you as well, and certainly not last, but not least at all, Kathy Little. Kathy, appreciate you. Just a couple of comments from someone who was so proud to have Speaker Ralston call me friend. Speaker Ralston had a generational impact on our state. Not merely by his years of service, but the care and love that he had for the members of this House that he loved so dearly, but more importantly, for the people of this state. Now, I tell you, it's pretty special today that three gentlemen that have led this state, that were friends of Speaker Ralston, are here today to help us pay tribute. But I think the measure of a person is built on relationships like this, but more importantly, is built on that relationship and caring about the least of us. Speaker Ralston was dedicated to the mental health and the well-being of the people of this state. His legacy will go on. This House, this General Assembly, and this Governor will help us foster that legacy in the years to come. I believe that I'll close with that on my comments, because I can think of no higher comment to say about an individual that they cared about their neighbor, they cared about their fellow man, and that they were a good, good man. Speaker Ralston was all of the above. And I thank the good Lord for sending David Ralston to Georgia, to his family, to his mom and daddy, to his brothers, and all of us who care so deeply about him. Speaker David Ralston was a friend. and his legacy will live on in so many different ways, but his remembrance for us members and for the public will certainly be very, very strong. As this portrait is placed on the entrance to this house chamber tomorrow, so anyone that enters the hallowed doors of the Georgia House of Representatives, when they look to their right, they'll see Speaker David Ralston. They look to their left, they'll see former Speaker Tom Murphy, two giants of this state who came from North Georgia, from the hills and mountains of North Georgia, who both of them loved dearly. But Speaker David Ralston has left a lasting imprint on us as individuals, but on the people and the well-being of all the citizens of Georgia. With that, I want to welcome the 81st governor of the state of Georgia, Governor, if I may, Governor Sonny Perdue, who's held many, many titles and many important positions of responsibility in this state. I know of the high esteem that Speaker Ralston had for you, Governor Perdue. And it's because of your friendship. I think he served with you in the Senate. He served this House very well as a member while you were governor, I believe. And certainly, Governor Perdue, you've made many important contributions to our state. If you would, I would appreciate, and the members would, if you'd come up and have a few words. Come on up here, if you will, sir. We'll let you come all the way up here.
Thank you, Speaker Burns, for offering me this honor of acknowledging the Speaker David Ralston. You've characterized him very well already. Best thing we can say about David Ralston, he was a good man. I first had the opportunity in January of 1993 to understand that when David first came to the Senate. I was in my second term. Many of you know I was serving as a Democrat at that time, David as a Republican. Those were the great days when we were able to reach across the aisle and really get a lot of good stuff done in that way, because David wanted the best for Georgia, and that was very clear, very evident from the very time. He had the DNA in his heart and his life and his family of public service, and he just wanted the best solutions for Georgia regardless of where they came from. He continued to demonstrate that while he was in the Senate. Sadly, I didn't get to serve with him that long in the Senate, nor did I get to serve with him while he was Speaker that long. We overlapped for 1 year. That's my regret, honestly, that we didn't get to serve together in those kind of roles for that long. But it was so clear to me, and I think, Speaker, you mentioned it, Speaker Burns, you mentioned it, the memory and the goal and the heart of David Ralston, you all have authorized to be perpetual at the University of Georgia with the mental health situation there at the University of Georgia. So his heart, his passion, his care for humankind, particularly those unfortunate, will continue to remain alive and well based on your actions in that way. We look forward to guarding that heritage, guarding that legacy very clearly as we go forward, because he was a good man, he loved people, he cared for people, he governed in a way that every one of you members could tell that he wanted the best for Georgia. Thank you for allowing me the honor just to speak briefly about my love and affection and gratitude for the service of Speaker David Ralston. Thank you all.
Thank you, Chancellor, Governor Perdue. Now, our next gentleman, we would love to come up and speak to his memories of Speaker Ralston, Governor Nathan Deal. Their service did not overlap. I think, Governor Deal, we talked about it. You were on your way to Washington when Speaker Ralston came into the Senate. And I think he had covered you previously as a reporter in Gainesville. How did he do on that? Was he fair? I'm sure he was. Reporters always are, aren't they? No doubt about that. So it's a great honor for me personally and for the members of this House to welcome you, the 82nd governor of the state of Georgia, Governor Nathan Deal. Governor Deal.
Thank you, Speaker Burns. I am honored to be with you all today. I see so many familiar faces and quite a few new ones. Welcome to the most deliberative body that you will ever be a part of. And I can say that having been, as your colleague Doug Collins did, at the higher level, this is the more deliberative body and closer to the will of the people. So thank you for having me. As the speaker indicated, my association with David goes way back. I had gotten out of the Army, and having come from Middle Georgia, my wife persuaded me that the North Georgia hills were a good place to be. Although she warned me that if I went to Gainesville, that I would never make any money because she had so many relatives they'd all want me to do free legal work. Fortunately, that was not the case. But that's where I met David Ralston for the first time. And yes, he was a reporter at the Gainesville Times, a young cub reporter. But he was always wise beyond his years, always going the extra mile to do his job the best he could. And he did. And then he decided to go to law school. Having known him in his experience there as a reporter, when I found out that he was getting close to graduating, I called him up and tried to persuade him to come join my law firm in Gainesville. But the pull of his part of the mountains was stronger, his family ties were stronger, and he went back home, which proved to be a very wise decision on his part. All the things that have been said about David Ralston are true. He was a good friend. He was the kind of person that you didn't have to go back and try to recreate your friendship every time you saw him. You simply picked up where you left off. You knew that you could depend on him. And as governors will tell you, one thing that you need is a strong Speaker of the House of Representatives that you can depend on, whose word is reliable. Because you make decisions based on that. And he, in turn, has to have the confidence of the body that he represents. And David certainly had that. As I have had occasion to speak on various occasions, people always come up and say, well, we appreciate your wisdom. Well, you know, I got to thinking about that. And I tried to decide, what is wisdom? Now, David Ralston had it. And this is my definition of wisdom. It is common sense that has been marinated by experience. And that's what David Ralston brought to the table. Common sense that has been marinated in the brine of experience. Thank you so much for having me today. To the family, my best wishes. You will always be a part of me and my heart. And all of you in this body. Thank you so very much. Congratulations to the family.
Need I say more? A very, very wise man, Governor Nathan Deal. Thank you, Governor Deal. One of the things that always impressed me about Speaker Ralston, he always wanted his family close by. That always impresses me about our current governor. So this morning, we're very proud to welcome Amy Porter to the House. We're very proud to represent our First Lady, Marty Kemp, as they support our governor, the 83rd governor of the state of Georgia, Brian P. Kemp. Governor Kemp, will you come forward?
Well, thank you very much. Well, thank you all, and good morning, Speaker Burns. It is an honor for Marty and Amy Porter to be with you today to honor a great man, an accomplished statesman, and a valued Georgian whose memory continues to abide here in this chamber. I am honored also to be standing with Governor Perdue and Governor Deal this morning. Governor Deal, I will tell you, I feel like I'm still being marinated. David Ralston had a big part in helping marinate me over the years. But as I said, after Speaker Ralston passed, he was so many things to so many people. He was a man of faith and a man of family, a loyal friend, a lifelong Republican. No doubt he was a proud North Georgian who talked about the mountains a lot. And he was certainly a commanding authority in this House, but I don't think he broke as many gavels as Speaker Burns has. He was also a fighter, though. You know, he was a fighter who always showed respect to everyone, regardless of what side of the issue they were on. He was a man of decency. And as we know, he was a passionate fan of the Braves and the Georgia Bulldogs. As mentioned, a champion of mental health reform, but also a master of political and American history, and as we know, so much more. I know all of us, has been expressed this morning, have memories of Speaker Ralston, and we will cherish them for many years. This portrait will serve as a lasting reminder of this man and of those memories. And for those that knew him, it will bring back moments of shared triumph and times of bittersweet defeat, made more bearable because of his friendship. It also will remind us of his booming voice that once reverberated through the halls of this Capitol. And it will remind us of all that he achieved during his long tenure under this gold dome, not just for the people of North Georgia, not just for Republicans, but for all Georgians. He was no doubt a great partner, especially when it came to matters of economic development and keeping Georgia the number one state for business. Now, I will just tell you, I'm sure when the portrait was unveiled and people saw that beautiful painting, they probably had many emotions and thoughts. But sitting right there where I was and those eyes coming right toward me, I just felt like he was looking, saying, y'all need to get your business finished. I'm not exactly sure what he might be wanting us to do, but I just feel like that gaze is telling us we need to continue our work here for the people of this state. And I know that every time we pass by this painting, certainly Marty and the girls and I will think about all that he accomplished during his years of public service, but also just those shared memories that we have with him. It will also remind us of his loved ones who are still here to safeguard that memory and that legacy. Cherie and Matt, Elizabeth, Dennis, and the rest of the Ralston family. Just know that you all continue to be in our thoughts or prayers, and may Speaker Ralston's memory continue to live on as long as this portrait hangs in these hallowed halls. Thank you all for having me. God bless.
Thank you very much.
Governor Kemp, I can let you know from personal knowledge, Speaker Ralston appreciated your leadership for this state through some very difficult times and in the good times as well. So thank you for your leadership and appreciate your comments and you and your family being here. We're getting down to the end here. Now, a lady that I know, we all know in this room, Ms. Cherie Ralston, who's Speaker Ralston. Loved, how about that? So very much. So if you would, Cherie, we would love to have you come up. Cherie Ralston, my friends, the wife of our late Speaker, David Ralston.
To be here without him. Every time I've been behind this podium, he's stood beside me. I'd like to first say thank you to this body for having our family here today with you. Thank you to Governor Perdue, Governor Deal, and Governor Kent for your kind words. Thank you, and I think I have quite a few people from House District 7 here. Thank you for being here. David Ralston loved you, and he worked hard for you, but he loved you so much. Thank you, Speaker Burns, for giving me this opportunity. Thank you all so very much. Thank you to the artist, but most of all, thank you to the University of North Georgia, who stays faithful to David Ralston, and he was faithful to you. Thank you so very much.
What a strong lady you are. We know that Speaker Ralston's work will always be on the forefront because you will make sure it's there, won't you? I can guarantee his other members that loved him. 2 points of personal privilege that I'm going to take. Congressman Doug Collins, a dear friend, thank you for being here. We appreciate you, your work in this house, for our country, and your service, and your service in Washington. Speaker Ralston thought the world of you, as you know. And on a more personal note, another lady that worked very closely with Speaker Ralston, who I also had the great distinction of working with me, I'm not sure she'll agree with that, but it's Pat Harris. Pat, we appreciate you being here. Speaker Ralston loves you very much, and we appreciate you. Thank you. All of our special guests in this Georgia House today, the members of this House appreciate you, governors, congressmen, friends, family, District 7. We appreciate those of you who supported Speaker Ralston over the years, the great work he did for the mountains of this state. We appreciate each and every one of you that have been here. Now we're going to close with a song. We're going to ask a gentleman from down in Dublin, Georgia, a gentleman who Speaker Ralston held in such high esteem, loved him as a brother. Chairman Hatchett, how about lead us in a singing him a happy birthday to the Speaker Ralston, what would have been his 70th birthday. Let's all stand and sing happy birthday to Speaker David Ralston. Chairman Hatchett.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. And if I may, y'all all know I'm a big guy, and he was a big guy. And just to remember to always tell each other that you love him, because he did that to me, and I did that to him. So keep that in your mind. And let's sing happy birthday.
Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday to you.
That concludes our work. Members, if you want to greet our guests, you may do that. We will pause for a few minutes. Thank you for all of our guests that made such a special effort to be here and for your words. Thank you so much.
Is that not true?
I'm sure the gentleman knows what he speaks. Have all members now voted? We've talked about this one an awful lot today. Have all members voted? If so, the clerk will lock the machine. On the passage of Senate Bill 233, the yeas are 91, the nays are 82. This bill, having received a requisite constitutional majority, is therefore passed. For what purpose does Minority Leader Rise?
Move for reconsideration.
No. Rule 144 of the rules of this House does not allow a bill to be reconsidered a second time. This bill has been reconsidered once already, so the gentleman's motion is out of order. We're moving on. This House is going to stand in recess after we have a couple of announcements. But first, members, I need your attention. Mr. Leader, I need you to come back to your desk just for a minute. I discussed this motion with you, this comment I'm getting ready to make. I want members to please take your seats. Ladies and gentlemen, this is a clear demonstration. We just debated a bill for a couple of hours here. You did it with respect for the other members, no matter how they voted. That is not the case over in the Senate with some of their members. There was a portrait right down front this morning. We honored a great Georgian, a member of this House, a former Speaker of this House. We celebrated David Ralston's service to the people of Georgia, with joy and celebration, along with his family of this House, three governors of this state of Georgia, and with his mama looking on at home. A member of the Senate, the senator from the 53rd district, took it upon himself to go to the well of the Senate, make some of the vilest comments that you can make about a good man. His comments impugn the integrity of my dear friend, and we all know they were not true. Speaker Ralston was a man of integrity, a man of service to this state. His reputation will live on in Georgia for years and years to come, for generations, because the policies that he empowered will impact Georgians' lives, and the work of this House will continue that work. Now, I must say, Lieutenant Governor and several members of the Senate defended the honor of Speaker David Ralston on the floor of the Senate. But I'm going to tell you what I'm going to do today. I'm going to ask the doorkeeper of this House, Corey Mulkey. No time in the future will the senator from the 53rd be allowed to come into that ante room or any property of the Georgia House. Mr. Minority Leader.
Mr. Speaker, I absolutely 100% second that motion, even though it's inappropriate. We, as a Democratic Party, as a Democratic caucus, stand with you in solidarity for what you just said. Thank you for saying that. We stand with you.
Thank you, Mr. Leader. Thank you, members. Corey, you have your orders. We expect you to enforce them and carry them out. Mr. Leader, members, it's a motion with emotions, as it should be. Okay, we have a couple of announcements. Thank you, members. Representative Dewey McLean is recognized for an announcement.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker.
Members of the House, we will stand in recess until 2:45. 2:45.
Thank you very much, Mr. Speaker.
The House is in recess until 2:45.